Who was your favourite?
It would have been Peter Smolik, but he's not here, so Josh Kasper.
Well, yeah, I totally rollerbladed. I did it in high school. I really liked it. And I know skateboarders don't like rollerbladers for lots of reasons. They get in the way. They're kind of like the scooters of today. But yeah, I did it. I loved it. I would do like ride backwards and do like a fakie 360 and land going down like a stair set. And I just had fun. I was a kid and I loved it. I never went pro, I never got sponsored. I do remember being on platinum and kind of leaving to go to blind, and kind of it started like a controversy of like, he used to be a pro rollerblader, like you don't want to sponsor him, like you don't want to like this guy basically. So it was kind of like a little hating on me, but yeah, I can't deny that you did. Like, why would I, you know? But at the time, fuck, it was embarrassing. Like, so. And maybe it still is. So, Carlsbad. Okay, so 360 flip did put me on the map. Before I made it in the video, I landed it with a helmet on because the one in the video and trilogy where I whooshed out and hit my head, the doctor told me if I hit my head in the same place within 6 weeks, I could die. So I went back six weeks later with the helmet on, and I did it. I also put my hand down. It wasn't that bad, but I'm glad I definitely went back and did it. So at that time, I was riding for Tony Hawk's company, Birdhouse, and he saw the footage. Maybe I wasn't on Birdhouse yet, and I think that was the trick that was going to get me on flow. You know, and that's fine. I mean, you know, this was years ago. Of course I was like, I'm the man here, right? But this is obviously, Tony Hawk is the man. So anyway, I did it with the helmet on. I got on Birdhouse Flow through Willie Santos. He's like an East County San Diego guy. Exactly. Yeah, since I did it with the helmet on, you know, he obviously knows how the industry works, the ins and outs, what's going to be acceptable and what's not. He's like, you got to go back and do it without a helmet on. So anyway, the one in Trilogy, I'm pretty sure I was on blind, because I remember on the drive home, I called Rodney Mullen and I told him I made the 360 flip in the guy's house that I was staying at, Darren's. From his car, it was like a weekday. That was an incredible thing that I actually made it, because it was a weekday. We're skating to high school, which is impossible. There was just something about it. Like, we were skating Climax, the old Transworld warehouse, and I did my first, like, I had no nollie tricks, no switch tricks. I don't know if you remember, I was terrible. Oh my God, I was so bad.
Yeah, but anyway.
Dude, over the Climax had a metal hip, and I was riding an 8-inch blind like lifesaver board. Maybe my memory's not correct, but anyway, I nollie backside flipped the pyramid, and Laban was there, Laban Fetus, I think that's how you say his name, and I landed my nollie backside flip. It was perfect. I was like, fuck, who saw that? That was awesome, right? You know? And I kind of made eye contact with him, I think, but then I told my friend who was going to film, I was like, dude, let's go. I got this 360 flip right now. Let's do this. And yeah, we went there that day and I did it. Yeah, Trilogy came out. I kept skating that stupid gap. And every time I drive there, get off the exit, it just brings up so much anxiety. Like, I hate it, but I want to conquer this trick. Uh, Okay, so I did the pop shove tail grab. I actually did a pop shove it also. I did the kickflip over the rail. I did heel flip. I did heel flip indie grab. I did 360 flip tail grab. I don't know if you saw that one. I did hard flip, and then I went back. This is years before Sean Malto, and then I went back and did a keg stand. I don't know. So, and that day was interesting because there was police that worked out at the high school, and I was rolling the, they weren't in uniform, but everybody knew I was rolling the keg past the police officers. Anyway, and then I benihanaed it, and I early grabbed it, but my friend had done it before me. dang. Oh, and the impossible. Okay. I think the jury's out. I think we already know I'm guilty. Ah, well, okay, so the gap with over the DJ, is the biggest thing. I mean, it's right next to Sarah High School. That's like the legendary San Diego Ledge School, Deer Dick, John Drake, Willie Santos. Anyway, there's this gap at the gas station right around the corner, and it's freaking huge. But so it was too big for me to want to try it, so I convinced, you know, one of the Osiris DJs to bring his turntables and actually set up play. We didn't rent it out or anything. This was all spontaneous. I got, you know, Grant Britton to take photos, which he probably hated me for. It drew so much attention. I ended up skating the thing for maybe a couple hours. It was crazy. The cops didn't come till later, and we still didn't get tickets. But I really felt that I needed lots of people, especially like a DJ, to jump over to encourage me, you know, or to like inspire or whatever it was. That's what I felt I needed to try it because it was so big. Like nobody had ever done it, you know, and. And in fact, Jamie in one of his interviews said that it was like the biggest gap ever ollie. This was years ago, but so I thought that was cool. But that's the stupid DJ Tater Santa gap. I mean.
Are you guys some Kasperholics?
Yep.
Kasperholics?
Yeah.
All right.
Kasper has a huge following. There's always about 20 kids following Kasper anywhere during the demo, trying to get his autograph. So we've nicknamed them the Kasperholics.
These are some of my fans here hanging out. These guys love me, don't you guys?
Yeah.
Thanks for coming over. Good timing. The kids, they're funny. They want to know like your shoe size, you know, why did you cut your hair after this one video?
Okay. Because I was a WWF fan, the World Wrestling Federation, and then... which is now the World Wrestling Entertainment. But yeah, I grew up watching Hulk Hogan as a little kid and stuff. And Chris Jericho, he had the Jerichoholics. So I basically stole that from him. I mean, even one of the things I did with Canton Russell, we had like an ad where we're both ollieing down some stairs and I made it look like we were gonna battle it out in a video and I put down some line, you know, I was like echoing The Rock, you know, cause he had all these great, like just real powerful, just slogans that he would say to like, you know, just make fun of his opponent. But that's where the Kasperholics came from. Blind somehow agreed to let me do my own website and it never failed like to just amaze me how much like I could kind of just they would let me get away with, you know, and so it was like a fan website, but like in like really for me it was so hard to believe that I kind of could have fans. Like I don't know if it's because of a low self-esteem thing or what, but it was so like an alter ego kind of thing. And it was like, yeah, I got the Kasperholics and I would have pictures of them. But in reality, I mean, like, it's, you know, you're a skateboarder. You don't really have fans. We like show each other how to do tricks and And yeah, it's like, it's not a real thing. Like, so I never expected people to take it serious, and I know I didn't, but now I would like to have an imaginary Kasperholics Anonymous, since I don't drink and stuff like that. They made me do t-shirts. We printed some boards. It was incredible. Like, they would let me use the blind, the stuntman graphic, and I was just blown away, like, you know. And people sort of took me seriously a little bit, not entirely. They were like, I kind of think they felt like, man, Josh is just losing it in his head, and perhaps I was, but it was fun, you know, while I was doing it. So I don't know.
See, that's what happens. It's one, okay, just one signature, all right, and then
nice one, cheers.
The rest of England comes over here.
No, it's very, well thought out. I've heard he's very intelligent as well. I didn't know him too well.
The amateur's been skating so well. Jerry Sue's been skating amazing, you know, all the time.
About that, I'm not that good to where I would, not be able to make a trick, or purposely, or, know I could make it. But I am sort of perfectionistic, but that kind of doesn't sound like me too much. I don't know, of course. I mean, that was kind of fun, you know? And you're kind of like, it's kind of spontaneous, you're there in the moment. The vert ramp thing, I remember being in Belgium trying to jump off their vert ramp, and I didn't make it. I tried and I slammed really hard, and I fucking, it's 12 feet or 13 feet, like, that's fucking high. I mean, what do you do? It's just like, well, thanks for coming, everybody. You know, I tried, you know, it was at the end of the demo too. And it's like, yeah, you look like an idiot. If all these people are here and you don't make it, like, duh, but.
And Casper's nickname is The, because he actually refers to himself as The Kasper.
I just think that's hilarious, if I say, Josh, would you like something to drink? And then I would reply, Josh has already got a drink, thanks anyway. I mean, that's just, it's funny, it's television, I don't know, you know, it's like, Jerry's just smarter than me, and he can do front foot impossibles and I can't. I don't know, man. Like, I was definitely, I could tell, like, I was being an idiot. I mean, I would, like, crowd surf, you know? Like, I'd be like, hey, hey, kids, like, here, hold me up, you know? And I would, like, create this stuff. you know, but.
Jeez,
okay. Yeah. Okay, so the helicopter limo, I do a lot of copying, apparently, because Tony Hawk, I heard, flew into a skateboard demo here in San Diego in a helicopter, and then it waited for him, he did the demo, and then left in the helicopter. So I was doing like a skateboard camp where I was giving awards out, so I ended up paying like $650, $700 for the stupid helicopter ride. And so it flew me from like Claremont to Mission Valley, which is like 3 miles. I don't even know, it's ridiculous. And then I convinced my shop sponsor, Avalanche, to pick me up in a limo. You know, they would of course pay for it. But Tom, the way he is, he figured out, you know, I was just trying to get him to pay for a limo, essentially. So he drove me around to skate parks and he would make me skate with the limo being there. You know, it's sort of a, you can't get the better of me, Josh. I know I'm smarter than you. And he was. But so that's all like the helicopter. You can spend your money on all kinds of stuff. But I mean, it's got plexiglass. You can see through the floor. I think the kids really enjoyed it. I don't know, it was dumb, but yes, I did that. Next question. Okay, so like my biggest month with Osiris, and it's this is a self-employed thing. So I'm an independent contractor, so I have to keep track of receipts. You know, I'm writing off stuff for music, for video parts, for computers, just everything. So this is before taxes and everything. But my highest month was like, I remember getting a check for my shoe sales from Osiris, and it was $12,000 something. And you know, for a young kid who's had three jobs or something like that, that's I mean, I went to Tony Magnuson, and I was like, looking at the check, I was like, what am I supposed to do with this? You know, he's like, he's joking around. He's like, I don't know, Josh, go buy a new car. You know, leave me alone, kid. I got to work. You know, he said, basically. And some of my checks from Blind were pretty good too. Like the royalties, like the sales hadn't been that high in years. You know, skateboarding has the ups and downs, and man, like there were some $5,000 a month checks. It was incredible. I was able to get like a Lincoln Navigator, so I felt like the rapper Fabulous. I don't remember what that song was, but I don't remember, man. But I was like, dude, this is it, you know. And of course, my interest rate, because my credit was so bad, was like 24%. You know, I was a $400 a month car payment or something ridiculous. But yeah, there were some good checks. Let's see. I was really just living, I don't want to say at the moment, but I was living for, I was just kind of trying to progress my skating, and I don't want to say the word career, but everything I was doing, I was trying to take it to the next level and stuff. And I read a thing about Dyrdek where he said to start one of those IRAs, and if you put, at 30 years old, if you put $5,000 a year, by the time you're 50, you'll have like $1 million or something. I did that, then I ended up withdrawing it. I was living for the moment, what can I say? Yeah, I was not saving. I loved to party and drink, so that's where my money went, a lot of it. And oh, I know, so I did, I rented a house, and it was, so it, you know, I had an office there. It was a two-room house, but it was on like an acre of land. This thing was like $1,900 a month. And yeah, like that's all my money. Just, yeah, I have nothing. I've had that since I was like a kid, you know, growing up in church and stuff. So, but I mean, definitely like, because you know what, it does play a part in this, because it's on the sadder note, but just to run over the top of it, I mean, like after, you know, my career or my skateboarding had, like, you know, I had gotten let go by Osiris and then Blind, and I was like, fuck, what the hell, you know. And I really, you know, was kind of like, okay, well, I gotta go back to, you know, mom, and you know, I need stuff, I need food. And so I just don't want this to sound like one of those stories. I'm like the idiot, you know. It's not like it has anything to do with like God and I walked away. It's like I knew the whole time. Dude, that was like, oh, it was like so sad, because Rodney called me for Blind. Osiris I wasn't as close with, but Blind had a lot of like emotional attachments. I mean, Rodney Mullen, just as a person, like took me under his wing, as he did so many people, I feel like. And getting that phone call, it was like, it was painful for him. And at the same time, I was just mentally, I knew I was just, I mean, he gave me like 3 months paid, you know, whatever, just to like, just to help you out, Josh. But I had already kind of known. I had moved up to LA to be closer with Blind. and it was just, it was too difficult. I remember going out to the Hollywood High 16, trying to 360 flip it, and I couldn't even get myself to ollie the stairs. I was trying it down the 12, and I was like, fuck, why am I doing this? Like, I've already done, I did Silvergate 14, I did Carlsbad Gap. People say all that guy can do is 360 flips anyway, so why keep going with it, you know? It's like, we'll be right back. I mean, yeah. You know, I had hard flips, pop shove it. It's like, what do I have, like 5 or 10 tricks? It's like, you know, you do it at the same spot, whatever. but it was hard. Sometimes I say to people, like, it became a job. And then I heard Ben Rayborn's interview, his Mountain Dew interview recently on the Ride Channel. What is that called? But he's just talking about how it's like a mental battle. It's like you love to skate. It's your dream to be a pro skater, and now you're doing it. And now you have to actually do this stuff, right, that you love to do. And so I don't know. Maybe I was pride or rebellion, whatever it was. I just stopped. I didn't want to do it. Maybe I became a prima donna. I still drank a lot. I don't know. My roommate moved out. I drank more, you know. I had the whole house to myself. and then now kind of going into, after I got let go, a couple years went by, I think, and I met some Christian sponsors, which is, you know, my faith from my childhood, and I still, that's still really important. And these guys were just really into like the similar thing that I was. And so I went on some tours with them. I screwed that one up as well. I also rode for Finesse for a little while, did the Ollie Impossible down the Carlsbad Gap. And then now, so I'm sort of still connected with Reliance, but they're up in Long Beach and I'm in San Diego, and I don't talk or text or email very well. As you know, I'm very bad at communicating. I still love to skate. I have some friends, but it's mostly skate park stuff. I don't know. I grew up jumping down stairs, and I'm going to be 40, so it's a little bit different. You know, you can't, the body just doesn't, it's in my mind. I totally want to do it. I mean, I see that 7-stair at the skate park and I just backside 180'd it, but I'm like, dude, I could impossible that. I could do this. And then I'm thinking like, yeah, but you could also get hurt. Your foot could come off. You know, you can't work, like, and it's like, and now it's like, now I see like the older friends that I've had, these mentor people, and it's like, now I see why you would watch me skate downstairs, because I'm the idiot, right? Like, I'm this idiot that thinks he can 360 flip the world, and you can't for a little while and stuff, but I don't know, maybe you can forever, but I don't know, I still love to skate, maybe a couple times a month, not as much as I'd like to. And I'm still a skate nerd. I love to watch stuff. Well, I mean, the thanks is huge, because it's really amazing to me that I was able to do all this, get sponsored by a shop. You know, I remember in eighth grade, saying to the teacher and the entire class, idiot, I totally regret doing this, but maybe it, I was like, yeah, I want to get sponsored by blah, blah, blah skate shop, you know? And the class just went silent, like, God, you're such an idiot, Josh. It was like, well, I don't know, this is what I want to do. And then, you know, I got sponsored by the skate shop, and then, you know, Willie Santos showed my video to Tony Hawk, and then, you know, Dorian Tucker showed my video to Jamie Thomas, and then Ronnie Krieger saw my video, gave it to Rodney Mullen. It's incredible that all this stuff happened, you know? So I'm totally, thankful and appreciative. It's been incredible, the stuff that was possible. The traveling, I still love skating.
Okay.
I love it. Fuck you, man. Okay,
cool.